And Grace Tame has become a household name since becoming Australian of the Year in January.
Yeah, after being gagged by a law that stopped her from speaking publicly about being sexually assaulted, Grace won the right to use her voice and, wow, she has been loudly campaigning for victims like her ever since.
Yeah, and this week she was named one of Time magazine's next generational leaders.
I do not regret speaking out. I never will regret speaking out. It's not a burden. It's no more my responsibility than it is any other human being's responsibility to be there and support other human beings.
She's inspired the nation. She's become a cover girl as well and was recently painted by a finalist in the prestigious Archibald Prize portrait competition. And we are so thrilled to have Grace back in studio with us. Grace, it's great to see you.
Yeah, it's great to see you guys as well. How are you doing?
What about you? How, you know, you're doing magazine covers. You've just been, named Time magazine's one of their next generational leaders. I mean, how's your head?
Oh, well, I don't know. I'm still the same little old me. I still go to Woolies in my PJs and bed hair, so I don't know.
Was it a bit fish out of water doing that that cover shoot with Marie Claire?
Yeah, I mean, that probably wasn't my, natural habitat. I'd just been for a run that morning and I tripped over a chain, so I had a big cut down my leg and my hands were all bleeding and, that was pretty typical
There's
me.
There's something so fierce about that cover. It's just like your eyes are just staring into your soul.
Well, I don't know. I don't know if I use the word fierce, but yeah.
How have you managed to balance the last 6 months? I mean, everything has been getting so, I guess, crazy for you, for want of a better word.
Yeah, look, I mean, I'm a pretty family-centric person, always have been. My whole world revolves around the people that I love and I always have someone close to me with me wherever I go. You know, I'm really lucky my partner Max always comes with me, and today I've got my best friend Madison who's sitting over there. You probably can't see her,
Maddie.
But I'm really fortunate in that way, and I just keep my feet on the ground and head out of the clouds and go one thing at a time. That's sort of my motto, I suppose.
One thing, I'd imagine there's so many things as well. Like I said, you speak so well with everything, and everyone really is kind of hanging on absolutely everything that you say. You're very much in demand. I have so much respect for you and everything that you do, and how you manage to stay you so much. Because I'd imagine there's a lot of people pushing a lot of causes with you at the moment.
You've got to take time for yourself. Yeah. Self-care is number one.
Yeah.
I like to use the analogy of if you don't fit your own oxygen mask, you can't fit anybody else's.
Yeah.
So I actually know that if I'm not 100%, I'm no good to the cause. I'm no good to empower anybody else. Mm. So I'm always running, I'm getting back in touch with meaningful values, simple times, pastimes, like swimming in the ocean, hanging out with friends, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, most definitely empowering
people. All that grounding
people.
Stuff.
Definitely.
Yeah, you've got
keeping grounded.
More bravery and more courage in your pinky than both of us on this couch put together.
Thank you.
After so long of not being able to speak, finally the law changes meant that you were able to speak and use your voice, and you have been using it so loudly. You have just blown so many people away with your speeches, with your interactions, the way you answer journalists' questions in the middle of the press club. It's a sight to behold. It is so, so impressive. But how are you finding other people are finding you using your power and using your voice? Are you finding that they're not really quite sure how to handle it?
Oh, it's funny that you say... it's funny that you say loud. I think that just because...
That's figuratively.
Just because a woman has been given a basic right to her voice and she uses it to call out injustice and tell the truth doesn't mean that she's loud. I mean, that is all I have done, is really tell the truth. And mine is an inclusive message. You know, just as I have been inundated by messages from female survivors, I've been inundated by messages from male survivors as well, you know, and that's a piece that's often forgotten. And actually, you know, it's predators who capitalise on this false division between men and women. It's not a battle of the sexes at all. It's a battle against abusive power.
Jeez.
Yeah.
Really? Is that triggering for you, Grace, having to...
Look, it's a strange intersection, you know, a strange intersection of experiences, OK? So I've been put in this position. I've been given this incredible platform, which is so wonderful. You know, a lot of people don't get that opportunity. But I'm also a 26-year-old, still only 11 years out from a very traumatic experience. Yeah. And so a lot of the things that I'm processing for the first time while under intense public scrutiny. And so often it's like in these situations where I'm live on national television and a journalist or reporter will ask me a question that puts my experience into a whole new context, and you kind of want to go, hang on, let me just go and have a cry about that, and then I'll come back and answer the question.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Actually, I've never thought about it that way. So you actually can't, it's almost like a giant therapy session in a way, some of this thing as well.
Oh, yeah, I don't know what it is. Yeah, because often it is. It's in the sort of the privacy of four safe walls that you get to analyse those sorts of things. But it's all a part of the learning process, and that's why I'm very inclusive, and I, you know, when I come across a, you know, maybe an ignorant question, rather than be adversarial or antagonistic, I try to work with the person who's asked me the question, and we try to figure it out together.
That's what's so refreshing about it. And I think that it adds so much to I say appeal because I can't think of a better word, the appeal that you have in that you have such strength, and again, there's no shy away from
weakness.
What I mean, what's right is right, and you never question that when you hear you speaking. You know, when it comes to when there's any sort of opposition in any kind of way, I'm not saying opposition, but people are waiting for you to say the wrong thing. But you always speak from your heart. There's an honesty there that people need to hear,
and especially humanity.
Exactly. This consent is it's a huge issue at the moment. Of course it is. We have great people like yourself speaking out about it. The government just can't seem to get it right. And I don't mean to put you on the spot there. What I mean more by that's my opinion. That's my opinion. Yeah. I'd like to know how would you try and explain it to teens? Because we're doing milkshake videos and everything that I just can't get my head around.
Look, I think the real issue is that there's so much inconsistency. You know, we have eight different jurisdictions with eight different definitions of consent. We also have eight different definitions of what a child is. We also have eight different definitions of what sexual intercourse is, what sexual assault is. And it's that lack of consistency that stops us from being able to develop a collective understanding of it and therefore educate and legislate around those things.
Yeah.
So I think it's about adopting some kind of standardised approach.
Yeah.
And what that is specifically, you know, I think that needs more work, I think.
At its very core, how would you explain consent to teenagers?
Well, it has to be active, you know, it has to be willingly given, it can't be coerced, but it also can be withdrawn. You know, when you agree to something beforehand and the circumstances change midway through, you should be able to withdraw that consent.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it just needs to be it needs to be an ongoing conversation.
Yeah. I think, like I said, when we talk about loud, I think what that is, it's empowering people.
You are unafraid. That's the thing. You are so unafraid, and
necessarily. I think
From what we see.
Yeah.
And I think it blows us away.
I think what we have a tendency is doing is we kind of go, right, well, Grace has all the answers. You know, and it's a lot of pressure there as well. So when I say loud and empowering, it gives people the strength to kind of think about it and kind of go, right, well, what would I do? And that's come from you. That's come from you. Yeah. But you shouldn't be put in a position where you have all the answers and you need to tell us what to do.
Yeah, and the thing is that we all need to be a part of this discussion. You know, we need the knowledge of experts, survivors, family, friends, bystanders, policy and decision makers, and strangers alike to expose the darkness and to in turn prevent it from happening. You know, everyone has a unique voice that nobody else can use, you know, no one else can tell your story. Yeah. And every contribution, no matter how small, is actually valuable because when you put it in amongst the collective, that's what creates huge progress.
We are loving having Australian of the Year Grace Tame sitting on our couch. She's now made global headlines after being named among Time Magazine's Next Generation Leaders for 2021. And Grace, you've got some more good news to tell us. What are you working on now?
Oh, well, I've just been in Brisbane this week working with the Australian Federal Police and the Australian Centre to Counter Child Exploitation, as well as some other major stakeholders in the prevention of crimes against children space. So the Morecambes, Bruce and Denise Morecambe, as well as Sonia Riley and an Indigenous survivor by the name of Justin Murphy, on a campaign called Stop the Stigma, which is about encouraging people to use their voice because it's in, you know, it's in our stories that we have information to educate and prevent these things from happening, which is really cool because that'll be a big national campaign that'll come out soon.
Oh, most definitely. It's huge. Yeah. And how are you... we know how busy you are, but how are you personally? Like, we know you have a very strong network around you. How's that gone?
Yeah, good. You know, I'm always leaning into the love that's around me and, taking time out for myself.
I guess my thing is because we know how much you're into your running and stuff, and I'm wondering now, because everyone wants you now at the moment, if that's still your kind of sacred place with your running and your kind of training.
Yeah. To me, it's very medicative and meditative.
Good girl.
Words to get out. I love how running grounds you, you know, and I especially obviously run outside. I'm not good at running on treadmills. I find them incredibly boring. But, when I go for my Sunday long runs, you know, I run for about 2 hours without music, just in nature, just in the present moment, literally taking one step at a time, which reinforces my motto that I use in every other aspect of my life, to just, you know, don't get too far ahead of yourself. You know, when you're running a marathon, I try to encourage people, don't think about K42, just get to the next K.
That's it.
And then before you know it, you're at the end. Yeah. You might be a bit sore, but you're finished.
Definitely the way you're on.
Yes, I trip over a lot.
Yeah, you're treating this year like a sprint. Now, nominations for the Australian of the Year Awards 2022, they close on July 31. Why do you think it's important to see someone nominated? And what would you say to perhaps the next Australian of the Year to be, if they're watching?
Well, it depends on what their cause is. But I think it's so important to have this, you know, awards program, because not only does it give us an opportunity to recognise the work of, you know, people from all walks of life that already has been done, but it gives a platform or elevates a platform for people to create further meaningful change. You know, as I said in my acceptance speech in January, there are still so many voices yet to be heard.
Yep.
And that's what this is all about, I think. You know, a lot of people can sort of be critical of these sorts of things, you know, what's really their value, but they're so catalytic, as we've seen just from this year. You know, it's only June, and my being named Australian of the Year has led to a whole series of events that have been incredibly positive and progressive.
It's been a real reckoning, hasn't it?
It really has, yeah. Well, we're very, very proud of you, and we'd love having you in here.
You're amazing.
Love being here.
Great to have
you. You can head to australianoftheyear.org.au to register your nomination. Grace Tame, come and visit us anytime.
I'll take that. Literally, you'll find me sleeping here
what
in the morning.
We get her a coffee. We get her something to eat. She's got to go for a run.
Yeah.
Have a good day, beautiful.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming in.
Thanks for having me.